Hi, my name's Andrew Lee, and I am a neuro-ophthalmologist here at Houston Methodist Hospital. Today, I'm going to be talking to you about a disorder that has no terrestrial equivalent. It's literally an extraterrestrial disorder. It is called Spaceflight-Associated Neuro-Ocular Syndrome, and it is exactly what it says it is. It is only associated with spaceflight. It is neuroocular, and it's a syndrome, and we call that SANS, Spaceflight-Associated Neuroocular Syndrome. So here we are on our planet, planet Earth, and orbiting our planet is the International Space Station. And NASA, as well as our partners in the other countries, the Canadians, the Russians, the Europeans, and the Japanese, have an international space station. And because there's no gravity, because the station is in low orbit, the eye has neuroocular findings. And so here's just a picture of your eye from the side to demonstrate what's going on in these patients. So under normal conditions here on Earth, the gravitational field of the planet is pulling down on all our fluids and our blood and our spinal pressure. And so all your physiologic processes are aimed at keeping the fluid aligned with your heart and your lungs and your legs. However, when you don't have the gravity, the fluid gets stuck upstairs. And so it gets stuck in the eye socket and stuck in your head. And for the eye, what that means is the fluid that's in your head is pushing forward and causing a flattening of the eye. This causes you to need stronger glasses, a hyperopic shift, like reading glasses. It causes swelling of the back of the eye, which is the optic nerve, and it causes folds, like folds in your laundry, because the eye is being pushed from the fluid that couldn't leave your eye and your head. And so this constellation of findings is called spaceflight-associated neuroocular syndrome. It usually develops within a few weeks to months of being in zero gravity. And of course, it's going to be an issue if we're going to go back to the moon and establish a lunar base, and if we're going to travel with a crewed mission to the red planet, Mars. It takes about 15 months to get to Mars, and we start seeing SANS, spaceflight-associated neuroocular syndrome, within a few months of no gravity. Luckily, no one's gone blind from the condition, even though it causes swelling of the eye nerve and these choroidal folds and the refractive change for which they need stronger glasses. No astronauts here on Earth have lost vision permanently. And even though the folds sometimes go away and the disc edema sometimes go away, sometimes the change in the structure of the globe doesn't, but nobody has gone blind and there's been no vision loss. The treatment, of course, is to come back to the gravitational field of the planet. And once they come home, the fluid goes back down and the signs and symptoms of SANS resolve normally over several months to a year with no permanent damage. And so studying SANS, of course, is going to have some terrestrial applications. Here on Earth, we see the same kinds of problems, fluid accumulation, swelling of the eye nerve, and these folds in the choroid. And so understanding the underlying pathogenesis of spaceflight-associated neuroocular syndrome obviously has importance to us here on Earth and neuro-ophthalmology patients here on Earth. And another side effect and side benefit of studying SANS is the distance between Earth and Mars is quite large, and it's about a 20-minute delay in the time signal. So when the signal is sent from Mars to come back to Earth, 20 minutes, and then a response 20 minutes the other way. And so developing technologies that can measure the eye in space, can determine whether people have SANS, and provide a real-time answer to our astronauts while they're flying is going to be a very important telemedicine aspect of studying SANS. It'll be the longest distance telemedicine project that has ever been done in the history of this planet, in fact, our solar system. I personally am very excited to be able to work with our space program as we prepare to go to the red planet Mars. And so developing AI-enabled technology and camera-based and other imaging technology that can travel with our astronauts to Mars is a really exciting part of what we're doing. And as you may recall, Houston was the very first word spoken from the moon when we landed on the moon on July 20th, 1969. Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed. And I'm looking forward to hearing our city's name, Houston, when it's spoken from the Red Planet.